You know, I was just gonna do some intro talking about gender dynamics and modern pop culture and stuff, but there's no way I could do that without offending somebody. And Work It is a show that should offend everybody. Before I get into the specifics of this, Drek, I want to give some context so people understand how and why this show came to be.
To me, Tim Allen is kind of like Olive Loaf, just on the wrong side of likability. To me, he's only been just kind of bland and annoying, not that much you can say about him. Yes, Home Improvement was a good show, but you could have replaced Tim Allen with Ray Romano or someone who wasn't caught up with more snow than an Alaskan train yard and didn't rent out all his friends to cover his own ass, and the show wouldn't have been that different. What made Home Improvement great was character dynamics and some good art direction to give it a distinct feel. Well, Tim Allen is relevant again thanks to the 2011 premiere of ABC's Last Man Standing. I don't get the appeal of this show at all. From what I've seen, it's basically Home Improvement with none of the passion, originality, and three daughters instead of three sons. With plenty of yo-ho-ho, men and women sure are different, aren't they, herp-de-derp-de-derp type of humor. My reactions to this show range from, heh, that was okay, at best, to eye-rolling annoyance at worst. Not even worth having too strong an opinion on one way or another. I think the show is popular with the kind of people who are inspired by the fact that an old white man came out as conservative, so basically it's not a show for queer, godless Mexicans like yours truly, but I can still think that it sucks and demand it be held to high artistic standards. In a world where waspy sitcoms are oversaturated, you have to do something special to stand out. You know, like, wish I could think of a show right now. I can't wait for the episode where Mike meets the Bundy militia.
So when Last Man Standing made Tim Allen relevant again, the powers that be decided it wasn't because of star power, it was because the people wanted shows about how damn hard it was to be a man.
Man Up is a Simon Pegg comedy that really captured the... Sorry, I'm thinking of something better. Man Up was a show on ABC. It was canceled because it had low ratings, but at least the premise could be somewhat interesting. Men in the modern comfortable age worry about their role in society, where masculinity used to be all hands-on doing things for most of history, and that paradigm is obsolete. It was no Portnoy's complaint, and pretty much every sitcom ever has done some variation of the real men storyline, but you could at least see how they would have gotten some smart ideas out of it. I mean, they didn't, but at least it had the potential on paper for some decent social commentary. So in the ashes of Man Up enters Work It, the epitome of suck. This show took a different approach to the idea of man session, whatever the shit that means, by instead of even talking about the differences of gender roles in society, even in the trite and moronic way that most of these shows would, they'd just say, screw it, let's put him in a dress, let's watch what happens. The kids in the hall does cross-dressing really well, but Adam Sandler's Jack and Jill did not. First off, the kids in the hall were very convincing playing the opposite gender, and that was important. Adam Sandler was not. And second and most importantly, because the kids in the hall were so convincing playing the opposite gender, the cross-dressing was never the only joke. Jack and Jill, because Adam Sandler was so unconvincing, that was the entire joke. That's not how you sustain a comedy. You can't do it with one joke.
And Work It is no Kids in the Hall. This show sucks. I remember it being heavily advertised for like 3 weeks before it disappeared off the face of the earth completely. But in the internet age, everything is forever. So I thought I'd take a look at one of the worst scripted shows in recent history by reviewing all 13 episodes, is what I would say if I could find them all. Yeah, even in the everything is forever internet age, some things are harder to find than others. Although the series was canned after 2 episodes in the US, the series in its entirety aired in New Zealand, because I guess we hate them. So I was able to find the first 3 episodes of Work It, which should be more than enough to show just how bad of a show this is. So strap in, ladies, and strap on, Danish ladies. Note that joke was still more respectful to trans issues than the Danish girl. Because this is gonna suck in a big way.
We begin the pilot with an establishing shot over St. Louis, showcasing the one thing that stupid city has to offer the American cultural lexicon, and we start with the only funny joke in the entire series.
Hey, honey, how did it go?
Well, the company actually folded while I was in the interview.
That was done a little better in Don't Trust the Bitch in Apartment 23, but I'll let it slide. So this is Lee, and Lee has been unemployed for about a year now. The recession is hitting him hard, and his HMO is about to run out.
Told you.
Oh, no, hey, Lee, as a woman, I'm going to have to ask you to stop comparing prostate exams to the pinball scene and the accused. No, it's not okay.
You're damn right that's not okay. Jesus Christ, who would even make that connection? Look at his wife. Notice the intent in her eyes, the I'm about ready to kick a mother effer stare. This is a very poor first impression on the character. And the weird thing is, that's the most offensive joke of the three episodes I've watched. It's not a shock comedy.
It shocked you with how bad it is, why?
It doesn't do stuff like this. This is not representative of the series as a whole. But we start off in the first minute with a joke about gang rape. Trying to make a funny rape joke is like trying to bet 41 on a roulette wheel. So this is people's first impression of the series, of the character? Even removing the context, this makes no sense. No sense at all. Well, that rant's over. Let's move on now.
Lee has a stock 14-year-old daughter that won't contribute anything interesting at all because that would involve two-dimensional characters. She, too, feels the effects of the recession and is used to drive home the point that Lee needs to get work. His best friend is Mexican, which is disappointing that a good brown actor had to be in this garbage. And, to add diversity points even further, they have another friend who has a severe mental impediment called Rusch's disorder, also known as being an MRA.
It's not a recession, it's a man-session. Look, women are taking over the workforce. Soon, they'll start getting rid of men. They'll just keep a few of us around as sex slaves.
Man-session. See, I thought that term was made up by the show, but apparently it's a real thing with, like, a definition and stuff. And it actually seems to be true, but not substantially, to the level that a man could not get a job for an entire year while most women would have no problem.
Not the kind of sex you like, Angel. Just kissing and cuddling and listening.
Yeah, not the sex you like, man. You know, whoever heard of 50 Shades of Grey and all that stuff and hypnosis fetishes and vorphilia. I have sought a female friends who are into vor. Maybe I need better friends. That's a different video.
After this scene, Lee goes to get his anal probe with a doctor that he's apparently been drinking with. I don't actually know if that's legal. I hope it is. And then overhears a woman talking about an opportunity for a sales job.
We're kind of just looking for girls.
Really? Why?
Well, we've had some guys, but the doctors seem to want to nail them less.
His desperation starts to hit him hard as he owes $900 to the doctor. And, eventually, we get the show's moment of inception.
Oh, well, wish me luck. Thanks for the tampon.
That reveal might have been the worst moment of television ever, excluding Japanese assassinations and everything that's happened on VH1. I'm not even going to get into the negative aspects that this show's universe would seem to imply based on the reality of their premise.
The doctors seem to want to nail them less.
Come on, I'm taking you out. Let's celebrate.
Okay, let me just go get changed.
No, what you have on is fine. We're just going to the bar.
The bar?
Yeah, yeah. I called Angel and Brian.
Angel and Brian. You know what? I suddenly do not feel like going out.
Okay. I'll just wake you up for sex later. Okay, wait. You seem mad. What is it?
Why don't you give it some thought and just see what you come up with?
The heterosexuals are at it again.
Well, I'm not sure you'd be up for everything this job requires.
But I'm Puerto Rican. I'll be great at selling drugs.
Wait, Angel is Puerto Rican, not Mexican? Well, okay, as a Mexican, I feel like we dodged that bullet. Also, is it a stereotype that Puerto Ricans sell drugs? Because Mexico and Colombia are the drug countries. They're stealing our reputation, those goddamned American citizens.
You must be the giant car saleswoman.
So, what's your story? Are you married? Wait, I'm really good at this. So no wedding ring, but I do see a tan line on your ring finger, so...
Divorced. Did he leave you for someone smaller?
Wow, you guys just dive right in, don't you?
These women are acting pretty intrusive, but seeing how I'm not a woman myself, I don't know if this is just how women act and they're making fun of the fish out of water joke, or if they're overly stereotyped and they're making fun of that. We're gonna need a female perspective to judge this joke objectively.
What the absolute fuck, Fox?
Thank you for that cameo, based Jesus. Yeah, I should have suspected it was the latter. Was it obvious the show was written by two men?
Everyone knows women can't eat sub sandwiches. Their stomachs aren't prepared to handle that. So Angel gets a job working for the Mexican government's space program when Lee walks in and decides to let the cat out of the bag after seeing the poor guy. Right here, we have a cross-dressing montage set to My Humps, the Work It of music. I mean, not the actual Work It of music, because that's actually a really good song.
So, what do you say?
I don't know, man. You have to understand, this kind of thing doesn't really fly in my culture.
Oh, because, you know, my culture just freaking loves it.
Oh, my goodness. That was actually some kind of social commentary. I mean, it was in joke form, but it exists. It talks about gender roles and the restrictions men face in a society that expects us to be masculine. Do you think they're going to follow this up with some more content about the role of masculinity in society? Maybe they'll talk about the LGBTQ elephant in the room?
Hey, Angel, bathroom needs cleaning.
I just cleaned it 10 minutes ago.
Welcome to Astro Taco.
So Angel joins the squad as a paraplegic chicken, apparently. We get another licensed song, but I don't recognize it. I don't particularly care. I'll put it in the video. You'll see what the song is called. Okay, so I'm going to address the LGBTQ elephant in the room. Cross-dressing is not the same thing as being trans, not by a long shot. When I heard the show was transphobic, I brushed off those criticisms, but having watched it, I see where they're coming from. Out of context, these two are the most offensive caricatures of MTF trans people I have ever seen. But I don't think that's what they were going for. They really messed up by not even mentioning the existence of trans persons in the series. Yeah, that's right. Of all the three episodes I've seen, no one seems to acknowledge out loud that being trans is a thing that exists. I'm not sure the show would have been less offensive by mentioning trans people, but it would have at least been more aware. And they don't even really try to make them convincing as women. It's not like the kids in the hall at all. I do expect the cross-dressing fetishists of the world to like this. There are millions of girls right now. Poor women. They can't even find good cross-dressing smut. Everywhere in the media they go, there is nowhere for them to find anything. It's hard enough being a woman in the world where all you do is get hired and make tons of money to buy expensive stuff. There is a need for cross-dressing smut in the world. For just pennies a day, we can make our own and send it all across America to everyone who needs it. Donate today. So Lee comes home and has money to do things, and now he has earned the right to sleep inside the house. The episode ends with Angel going up to a girl to get a restraining order.
You have no visible panty lines. How do you make that happen?
I'm not wearing any underwear.
Yeah, that's not gonna work for me.
Alright, well, that episode sucked. Let's watch some more of this crap.
Lee has apparently been leaving women's fashion magazines in the bathroom like the internet doesn't exist.
Oh,
gross, Dad. Get some real porn.
You can tell she's the kind of person with a terabyte of choke porn on her hard drive.
Oh, shoot.
Whatever. I'll see you tonight. I gotta pick up Angel.
Lee, you just spilled juice all over yourself.
Yeah, I know. No one's gonna notice.
Babe, it's pretty obvious.
Yeah, you know, people at this job, they don't seem to notice things that are really obvious.
Okay, is it me, or was that orange juice actually really hard to notice? Like, it's mostly covered up by his tie. That's like a basic level of not working.
Zacrosystemax.
Sacromistimax. Zacatac?
Zacatac?
Wow, this joke is really stupid. Zastrosystemax. 5 syllables. I don't know how you get Zacatac from that, but yeah, must have been hot day in the writer's room.
No, thank you. If I wanted a lecture, I would have gone to medical school. Oh, wait a minute. I did.
The delivery of that line was so bland, it's supporting Chris Van Hollen for Senate.
Stop it!
You stop it!
I tell you, don't you forget to come back with some more of these samples, because I tell you, I'm going to be prescribing Zacrosystemax to all of my asthma patients.
Little do those poor asthmatics know that Zastrosystemax makes you grow an extra foot. So basically, the conflict of this episode is that Lee can't sell things legitimately while Angel just flirts and sells all the things that he wants. Okay? Okay. We're back at the bar with Tweedle Lee, Tweedle Fuckass, and Tweedle Dumbass, And apparently, Tweedle Dumbass is Lee's brother-in-law.
My own brother-in-law won't get me a job.
It would have been nice if that were clear earlier. At least now we know why we're hanging out with him.
Oh, hi. May I please speak with Angel?
This is Angel.
Oh, I'm sorry. This is Dr. David Deutsch. I was trying to get a hold of the woman who came into my office this morning.
Yeah, that's a thing that bothers me. Why don't they use different names? They know Facebook is a thing, right? Does this take place in the 90s when the economy was good?
But what I actually wanted to ask you is whether you would like to have dinner with me.
Dinner? Together?
I legitimately don't know why the audience is gasping. Is there a single person who would have been surprised by that development?
The doctors seemed to want to nail them less.
No, she didn't know her stuff at all. The only reason she did well is because she came out of the doctors like some kind of hoochie mama.
Hoochie mama? Is Pam Grier going to show up and kick somebody's ass? Because that would make everything I've seen so far forgivable.
Oh, is it hot in here?
It is 63 degrees.
63 degrees? And they're not shivering? It's like 80 and I'm wearing this. God damn it, Midwesterners. Why do people live north of where I do?
Your minute is up, Miss Standish.
Whoa, slow down there, Keith. Oh! Oops. I better get that so I can put it back up on your... Uh-oh.
I want you to pay close attention to that whale tail. Pay close attention to it. I want you to know that someone got in a writer's room, wrote this, got approval from the other writers, it went by some executive, and he approved it, and it was presumably focus grouped by what I assume are an army of Tweedle dumbasses, and they approved of it. And this is what the writers originally thought that you, yes you, the viewing audience of the United States of America, wanted to see on your TV so badly, so desperately, this. This is what they think of you. And the studio audience just loses their shit. So Lee believed in himself and gave a motivational talk, and eventually he got rid of a sample of those drugs. Hooray? Hooray. Meanwhile, Angel is on a date with that pervert doctor who... Wait a minute, he looks pretty familiar. Do I know him? Huh, that's Stephen Tobolowsky. Yeah, he's the principal on the Goldberg, and apparently he's also done everything else ever made. I guess Work It is less of a stain on his resume than the Christian Mingle movie. So Lee walks in being all big damn heroes, pretending that Angel is his girlfriend to save him from the creepy doctor. Those patrons are so nonchalant that this scene is clearly happening. That's just bad direction that no one even looks behind them or just reacts like a normal person would in a triumphant scene like this. The episode ends with them eating desserts at an empty restaurant because I assume they just started fucking on the table right then and there. And then we get another scene where Angel can't say Zastro System X.
Zastro System X?
That joke is getting old.
Well, we're 2/3 of the way through and I'm still good on Lexapro. So, might as well finish the series up with the episode that did not air in the US but did air in New Zealand. Let's check it out.
So this episode starts with a trivia night at the bar, hosted by Riddler Tyler Labine, where Lee and Angel fight against Tweedle Dumbass and Cat.
I hope you like wine, because your grapes are about to get stomped!
Yeah, okay, I can see how they might be related now. It was always one of my pet peeves in really any work of fiction whenever siblings look absolutely nothing alike. I mean, I know this can obviously happen in real life, but I mean, you know, at least try.
Crushing it!
You're not crushing anything, you're just repeating what Lee says a second later.
No, I'm not. He's repeating what I say a second earlier.
Angel and Lee really do seem to have good chemistry, even if they are just reading lines from Scrubs verbatim. So we cut to them at work, where apparently none of them have tampons in their purses, and that attracts curiosity from the other girls.
That's the strangest thing I've ever heard. I've just never met a woman that didn't carry at least one tampon at all times.
Yeah, maybe they carry pads. Also, not all girls menstruate. That's a very superlative statement to make.
No, we usually have one. It's just that we used it.
We used it.
We cycled together and we went halfsies.
Yeah, that's a nice mental image, for the record. Instead of just assuming a person said the wrong semantic, like, you know, they instead of it or whatever, they just go right for two girls, one tampon. You should have just kept that one from the girl who gave it to her in the first episode.
Well, me and Vanessa are in a blackout.
Okay.
She's feeling around and she finds what she thinks is a flashlight.
Flashlight or a birthday can.
But when the blackout hits, no condoms for you.
That scene with Angel planning to seduce Vanessa has nothing to do with anything. I just wanted to point out that these characters are morons. We cut to the office girls leaving to go get coffee, giving away to the most obvious setup for a cringe comedy joke ever. As Angel and Lee investigate the other girls' purses while talking at full volume. But, you know, that's a problem across most sitcoms. And to the show's credit, I guess, they don't go full Curb Your Enthusiasm, and only the crazy girl kind of catches them in the act, where Lee lies about being intimidating instead of saying something like, I've wanted to learn about it and I'm curious. Not that the show does anything with this lie. Yeah, I want to give the show more credit for not going with the obvious joke, but part of me thinks it's too incompetent to know how to set up a joke properly with context. Lee and the crazy girl start to bond over the latter's child, who is being picked on.
Oh, and I tell him, when you're being teased, hug the teaser.
Do they seem to imply that women can't get bullied? Because, yeah, that's not true, like, at all. And Angel starts to get jealous because they're hanging out a lot. He ends up going to trivia night by himself and sucking at it.
Because of its clouds of sulfuric acid, this is the deadliest planet.
Planet of the Apes!
Angel's angst is exploited by the British bitch who bitches Britishly.
Oh dear. Are you gonna cry?
And, you know, this one says something.
Kids, they both say, don't let that guy drive you home, Kelly. He's not really Donald Trump.
And if it were Donald Trump? Damn, I don't care how much money he has. You'd have to live knowing that this was inside of you. Plus, for pillow talk, he'd probably read you one of his Hitler speeches or something.
So a magazine quiz convinces Angel that his anxieties are real. Yeah, a magazine quiz. Yeah, this show is filmed in the 90s. It's the only explanation.
Thought you might want to break out the video games.
Oh, we don't have those. Video games promote sass.
Well, I mean, losing at video games promotes sass anyway. But she has to be in, like, in her 20s. Has she never played Crash Bandicoot at a friend's house? I'm sorry, I find that a little hard to believe. I mean, what else could they possibly do in St. Louis besides playing police tape tag?
So Lee assures Angel that he is not being replaced and problem solved? That's a fast resolution. So Lee does things with the crazy lady instead of something else I don't know, and then the fight starts up again literally two scenes later. And then we get to a cat fight for like half a second.
Are you two fighting?
Yeah, it took them 3 episodes to come up with a catfight, and then they don't even follow through with it. Again, I would give the show more credit for not being predictable, but I don't think they even know how these cliches work. Anyway, the conflict is resolved due to a series of allegorical statements that Angel and Lee make about their cross-dressing as a reason why they should trust each other. I mean, I guess that makes sense. It doesn't really address the root of the conflict, and also it really just feels shoehorned. Yeah, I'm not really making this up. This entire episode just doesn't really seem to be consistent. Angel makes a barrage of awful puns that make me want to drink.
I'm sorry I wigged out. I'm glad we're able to make up. And now we can just tuck all this junk behind.
And now we can just tuck all this junk behind.
The stinger to this episode takes place at Trivia Night, where Angel and Lee are one question from winning. And the answer to the question being won is a callback to another joke that I didn't remember at first because I had no reason to, because there was nothing that recommended it was worth remembering.
What is a poncho?
It was one joke, and they called for it again. Yeah, you see what I mean? They're incompetent. Lee's daughter isn't in this episode, but I'm hoping that there's a future episode where she discovers and accepts her dad's cross-dressing, and then she becomes Haruhi from Ouran High School Host Club.
So those were the first 3 episodes of Work It. I mean, they were the only ones I could find again, but I think they give a good idea of why this show sucks. The premise is dull, the writing is lazy, the writing doesn't even make sense sometimes in respect to how they deal with plot lines. I have no idea how the show was greenlit, or how it got produced in 2011, and aired in 2012. But clearly it did. ABC is ashamed of this show, and they should be. So what did you think of the show? Did you think it was a hard suck, or that it was just a soft suck? Do you think you can do a better review, or do you want to worship at the altar of me? Write your feedback in the comments section. Be sure to subscribe to encourage the madness yet to come. Like this video so my ego can get a boost, and share this video with all your friends you no longer want to. There's a new review video coming in 2 weeks, so in the meantime, take care and see you. Kitty. I got cat beard. Ah, you little dork. You a little dork.